Here's tonight's headline. Is this real life? In the midst of this worldwide health crisis, life as we know it has stopped. Entire states, California, New York, and Illinois, to name a few, are essentially locked down, accounting for more than a quarter of all economic output in the United States. The Dow has wiped out over 3 years of stock market gains. The State Department has said do not travel abroad. Canada has closed its borders. The U.S. and Mexico are working on a similar plan to restrict travel across that border. As of yesterday, 45 states have closed schools, affecting at least 53.7 million students. Offices are shuttered and many Americans have been laid off. Economic forecasters predict the unemployment rate could rise to 6% by mid-2021. 3 million jobs could be lost by summer. Hospitals all over the country are overwhelmed and undersupplied. Doctors and nurses need life-saving PPE, personal protective equipment like masks, gowns, and gloves, and cannot get them. Many of us are healthy and doing everything we can to stay that way, including staying home. Some of us are sick and trying desperately to get better. In some cases, that means just trying to get tested for coronavirus. And yes, some are dying from this virus. You can see the number of lives lost on the right of your screen. For the 330 million Americans dealing with the impact of all of these life-altering disruptions, it doesn't get any more real than this. While everyone understands that science, research, and doctors and medical experts will solve this problem in time, and they will. Until then, we are relying on our leaders, our mayors and governors, the President of the United States, to do some very important things right now. Number one, keep us safe as best they can. Number two, give us accurate information in a timely fashion. And number three, calm our fears. Governor Cuomo in New York, Governor Newsom in California, Governor DeWine in Ohio, my governor in Connecticut, Ned Lamont, and hopefully your governor, wherever you live, have taken to regular press briefings that have been informative, serious, and sometimes even reassuring. We are thankful for them, and we'll be talking later in the show about statewide responses to this crisis. But at the federal level, I hate to say, our leadership is missing the mark. In seeing this coming, in deploying resources, in quickly using the levers it has, in giving us accurate information, the federal response has been lacking. And the president, whether he agrees or not, is responsible for that. From first insisting that coronavirus was Democrats' new hoax, to saying the virus would miraculously go away, to flipping to this was a pandemic and he always knew that, to blaming the Chinese and Obama, even the media, for his own failures, to contradicting his own experts and spouting misinformation, President Trump is failing the biggest test of his or any presidency. This was the president yesterday when he was given the opportunity to do the most basic thing he can, which is reassure Americans in a time of crisis.
What do you say to Americans who are watching you right now who are scared?
I say that you're a terrible reporter. That's what I say.
I think it's a very nasty question, and I think it's a very bad signal that you're putting out to the American people. The American people are looking for answers, and they're looking for hope. And you're doing sensationalism, and the same with NBC and Comcast. I call it Comcast. Let me just ask for whom you work. Let me just tell you something. That's really bad reporting. And you ought to get back to reporting instead of sensationalism. Let's see if it works. It might and it might not. I happen to feel good about it, but who knows? I've been right a lot.
Also yesterday, what is becoming dangerously typical of Trump right now, oversimplifying and overselling the truth.
There is no magic drug for coronavirus right now, which you would agree. I guess on this issue,
I disagree. Maybe and maybe not. Maybe there is, maybe there isn't. We have to see. We're going to know.
And on Thursday, getting important facts wrong, saying the drug chloroquine was approved by the FDA to fight coronavirus. The FDA immediately corrected him, saying in a statement, there are no FDA-approved therapeutics or drugs to treat, cure, or prevent COVID-19. Dr. Fauci took to the airwaves later that night to reinforce the message.
There's no magic drug out there right now.
Here's the deal. This is so incredibly unfortunate. This is so incredibly dangerous that we cannot trust what the president is saying is an awful, inexcusable tragedy. And look, this is not about politics. Yes, I disagree with the president on many issues. I also agree with him on some. This isn't about liking or disliking the president. I want this president to succeed. I hope you do too. But right now he is not, and we need to be honest about that because it will cost lives. Leadership matters. We don't have to go back through the annals of history, back to FDR and World War II or JFK during the Cuban Missile Crisis. We can look at recent history for bipartisan examples of what leadership looks and sounds like. In the days after 9/11, President Bush addressed the nation many times. Here he was in a joint address to Congress, urging Americans not to take out their anger and fear at Muslims.
Americans are asking, what is expected of us? I ask you to live your lives and hug your children. I know many citizens have fears tonight, and I ask you to be calm and resolute, even in the face of a continuing threat. I ask you to uphold the values of America and remember why so many have come here. We're in a fight for our principles, and our first responsibility is to live by them.
And here was President Obama, not even a month into his first term, telling Americans that the economic recession will be hard, but we will survive it.
That's the test facing the United States of America in this winter of our hardship. And it is our duty as leaders and citizens to stay true to that purpose in the weeks and months ahead. After a day of speaking with and listening to the fundamentally decent men and women who call this nation home, I have full faith and confidence that we can do it.
You can call me naive, you can send me emails, you can yell at me on Twitter, but I don't think it's too late for Trump. I hope he is able to muster the discipline and compassion and selflessness to do better, to be better. Our lives depend on it.